The grueling college basketball season has come to a close. 68 teams have made the tournament, and only one will come on top. Now, our newly elected president has put an end to the presidential bracket, so we decided to bring you the next best thing. Our CCS staff will make their own predictions and analysis on what's going to happen in the upcoming big dance. And we're going to kick things off in the South region. The first matchup we have is UNC and Texas Southern. Thomas, what do you think is going to happen in this one?
This isn't too intriguing of a matchup. We've seen this trend before, a 1 versus a 16 seed. It's never happened, and that trend will continue. North Carolina will advance to the round of 32.
The Tar Heels are very formidable this year, that's for sure. And all right, this is more of an interesting game. Arkansas versus Seton Hall. Both teams have played really well. I personally saw both these teams play. Arkansas at the SEC tournament and Seton Hall in Madison Square Garden when they took on the Gamecocks and defeated the Gamecocks by 1 point in a great matchup. Both these teams can play good defense and put up points. I personally think Seton Hall is going to take it. I don't know about you, but
I personally like Arkansas in this matchup. They're kind of hot right now. They just faltered to Kentucky in that matchup in the SEC championship game. But Kentucky's a whole different animal than Seton Hall. And if Arkansas is playing their best basketball, which I think they are right now to compete with big guys like Kentucky, I think they're going to be able to take this matchup and move on to the round of 32. I got Arkansas going ahead.
You're right. I mean, they've played phenomenal down the stretch, and they played very well in Nashville. Next, we have the always crazy 5-12 matchup where you see a lot of upsets in general. And I think this year, this is the one 5-12 matchup that is primed for an upset. Because Minnesota, in my opinion, they had a great year, but I think they're ranked too high. And I also like Middle Tennessee here. I mean, they played very well last year. They beat Michigan State in that first round. And that was when I think they were, what, a 15 or 14 seed last
year? They were a 15 seed
and they did that. And so, I mean, I think Middle Tennessee, and I like the way their guards play, and I think that's going to give Minnesota a lot of trouble. And I think Middle Tennessee is going to take this. What about you?
Yeah, I agree here. Middle Tennessee primed for an upset. Minnesota seeded way too high. They lost to Wisconsin twice in the regular season, and they've just been seeded way too high. They lost really early in the Big Ten tournament, and Middle Tennessee is going to take this matchup.
All right, and then next we have Butler and Winthrop. Both these teams are similar in the fact that they're not huge schools, but they play good basketball. I mean, Winthrop won their conference this year, and they've made the tournament now for the first time in a while. But I think Butler's just too much for Winthrop at this point. I don't know about you.
Yeah, this matchup is going to be closer than a lot of people are going to think, simply because of the fact that Winthrop has some playmakers that nobody knows about because of the conference they play in.
Yeah.
Keon Johnson, one of the best point guards in the Big South and in the country. He averages 22 points a game. Mm-hmm. They also have another guard that averages almost a double-double every game. If you don't think Winthrop can match up with Butler, then you are dead wrong. It's going to be a close matchup. But again, I think just the pure talent of Butler is going to outmatch Winthrop in this one. I think Butler moves on. But look out for Winthrop. They could cause an upset.
Yeah, the Winthrop, they're the Eagles, right?
They are the Eagles.
Yes, the Winthrop Eagles, they can shoot the three ball. That's the one thing that I've realized from them this year and in that Big South tournament. So, I mean, I wouldn't be surprised if there's an upset here. But I just think Butler's a little too much to handle. And they've been here before, and they know how to handle these situations. So that's why I have Butler. But don't be surprised if there's an upset.
Yeah, it's definitely going to be one of the better matchups in this region.
All right, and then the next matchup we have is Cincinnati versus either Wake Forest or Kansas State. We don't know which team they're going to play yet. But in my opinion, I think Cincinnati can defeat both those teams. Cincinnati has had an under-the-radar type of year. They played well this year, and I think their guard and their bigs are going to be too much for either of these two teams to handle. I don't know about you, though.
Yeah, I agree. These two teams are playing a play-in game for an 11 seed, both not too impressive this year, especially when you match up against a team like Cincinnati. They just lost in the conference tournament to SMU. I think Cincinnati wins this matchup between either of these teams.
All right, so we both agree and have Cincy moving on. So now we get to UCLA and Lonzo Ball versus Kent State. Now, I think UCLA is one of the better teams in this bracket. They are a 3 seed, but that doesn't really mean that they're not better than even the 2 or 1 seed in this bracket. So I think they're going to handle Kent State well. They've played a lot of tough teams this year. The only teams that they haven't played well against is other teams in this bracket. So I just think UCLA is going to handle this one with ease. What about you?
Yeah, it's going to be a short trip to the dance for Kent State. The Golden Flash is good for them getting into the tournament. But UCLA, with that powerful offense, Lonzo Ball and his squad are going to take them on, and they're going to take them to the round of 32. They're moving on.
They're going to make John Wooden proud. So the next game is two teams that always make a splash in the tournament. You got the Dayton Flyers and the Wichita State Shockers. And for me, it's going to be sad to see one of these two teams lose, because I remember when Wichita State made their fantastical run like 3 or 4 years ago, or when Dayton beat Syracuse in the first round. But I think personally this could go either way. This is probably the closest 7-10 matchup we have. And I'm going to go lean towards Wichita State, but what's your thoughts on this game?
Yeah, I'm going to have to agree with you there, Ben. I'm probably going to lean towards Wichita State. They've been playing great basketball. Mm-hmm. They've been flying a little bit under the radar just because they have a lot of young guys that aren't too flashy. They don't have the veterans that they've had the past couple years, but they can still make a run. They can definitely beat Dayton. It'll be a great matchup. But I think Wichita State's moving on in this one.
All right, that's probably not the right abbreviation, but we're going to go with it. And last but not least, in the first round, we have Kentucky versus Northern Kentucky. I mean, for the first off, look at how many Kentucky teams are in this bracket. But I think Kentucky's going to handle this game with ease. Monk and Fox are just too much for Northern Kentucky to handle. I mean, I think Northern Kentucky has some scores, but, like, you can't outrun Kentucky. And Kentucky just played great in Nashville. They didn't play their best at the beginning of the tournament, but they really started clicking towards the end, and they defeated Arkansas in that final. So I'm going to have Kentucky moving on. Do you agree?
Yeah, I definitely agree with you there. Kentucky, they can win this game off just talent alone, but they don't need it. They've got a great coach, one of the best ever in Coach Calipari, and they'll easily take this matchup. Kentucky moves on.
I agree. Now, moving back up to the top, you have another great coach with Roy Williams playing Arkansas, and Arkansas's coach is really good too. And they've been playing great basketball. I think this is a chance for Arkansas to really show that they belong in this tournament if they make it this far. I think they can give UNC a run for their money, but I just think UNC with all their firepower on offense is going to be too much for Arkansas to handle.
Yeah, I like North Carolina in this matchup. If you remember, about 2 years ago, I think they faced off in the round of 32, and UNC won that matchup to move on to the Sweet 16. I like UNC in this matchup. They're one of the best rebounding, if not the best rebounding team in the country. Mm-hmm. And you got Joel Berry, Justin Jackson, and a lot of those other guys that can score anywhere.
All right. Now, who do you think is going to win this mid-Tennessee Butler game?
I think it's an easy choice. I think it's Butler, and a lot of people will disagree, but people don't understand that Butler has been playing second fiddle to Villanova in the Big East for many years now. Butler deserves their shot to move on to the Sweet 16, and they're going to get it in this matchup.
I agree, because I think Middle Tennessee, although being a great team in their own right, I think Butler, if Butler gets past Winthrop, I think that Butler has the better matchups just guard-wise, and even with some of their bigs, Butler's just, like you said, they get overshadowed by Nova, and they get overshadowed just because of the conference they're in. I think Butler is going to handle this one. Now, moving down, we have Cincinnati and UCLA. Now, this is going to be a great game. I do think UCLA has a little too much for Cincinnati to handle, but I wouldn't be surprised if Cincinnati gives them a run for their money. But for me, I think UCLA and Lonzo Ball and their high-octane offense, I think they're going to be too much for Cincy. What about you?
Yeah, Cincy, they're tired. They just came off the conference championship game, which they lost to SMU. UCLA, they've had time to rest. They lost in their conference tournament. So they're probably going to be pretty fresh for this game. Lonzo Ball is going to be dropping dimes to his teammates in this game. UCLA is going to win with that high-powered offense.
Dime-dropping delights. All right. Now, the final game we have in the second round is Wichita State and Kentucky. And I honestly think Wichita State has a shot to beat Kentucky just because of the way Wichita State's team is formed and how they can run. And their defense is pretty underrated this year, in my opinion. But Kentucky is just too much for me for them to handle. I think Kentucky is going to win this game in a closer game than a lot of people think. But I think just with Fox and with, like I said earlier, Fox and Monk and their role players on that team, they have sharpshooters. They have everything you possibly would need. I think Kentucky is going to handle that game.
Yeah, this is going to be definitely an interesting matchup if everything plays out like we see on this bracket. Kentucky, there are question marks there. They have a lot of young talent, as they do every year. Mm-hmm. So there's definitely a chance for them to get upset when they play pretty good teams. Mm-hmm. But just on talent alone, you got Briscoe, you got Fox, you got Monk, you got Adebayo, you got all those guys. Kentucky wins this game, but it'll be a close one.
I agree. All right, now moving back up, we got UNC Butler, and that's going to be a great game. I mean, both teams have been in that position again. I mean, before, both teams have been in that position, and now they'll have to fight in another close matchup. I think Butler, who's no longer coached by Brad Stevens, but that's not an issue for them, as they've obviously played fantastic all year. But I think UNC just has too much firepower again for Butler, and I think it'll be a close game, but I just think in the end I have more faith in the guard play of UNC, and I think they're going to take this.
Yeah, UNC's really been able to play both ends of the floor, especially with the play of their rebounding, and they shoot really well, especially with guys like Joel Berry. They're going to move on to the Sweet 16. Or is that the Elite Eight?
That's the Elite Eight. It's okay. All right, now the matchup that everybody wants to see in this bracket, if it all goes chalk and it all happens, this is the matchup that everybody wants to see, UCLA and Kentucky. This could honestly go either way because both teams have enough talent to kind of combine with or match up with each other. So, I mean, personally, I like Kentucky, although I can see UCLA winning as long if Lonzo Ball has a great game and if some of their role players step up. But like, if they try to outrun Kentucky, this is probably the one team in the tournament that they cannot outrun, at least in my opinion. So I would say Kentucky, but you're more than welcome to disagree with me.
Yeah, I'm going to agree with you there, Ben. UCLA, they've got to be on their best to beat Kentucky. Kentucky has one of the most talented teams in the country. They've got young guys. They're coming in hot. And I think Kentucky is going to win this matchup. Unless UCLA has their best game of the season, I think it's Kentucky.
All right. Well, I'm glad we agree. Now, we've seen this matchup a lot and before. And I mean,
this year, right?
Yeah, I think they both played this year. I mean, and I can't remember who won that game for the life of me.
Kentucky won.
Okay. And it was... And it was a great game, that's all I remember. I remember seeing it go back and forth. But like, this is a tough game for me because both teams are so talented and they're both good in different ways. Like, and if this becomes more of a half court offensive game, I think it favors UNC. Even though both these teams like to run, but I think if it becomes back and forth, I think Malik Monk is just going to be too much for that team with Josh Fox and Briscoe, like we said before. But me personally, I think UNC is going to take in a close one. You're more than welcome to disagree with me because at this point, it's either or, it's a toss-up. But like, what's your thoughts on this?
Yeah, this game is definitely going to be a toss-up. I just see UNC with a slight edge because of the experience they have on that team. A lot of their guys that get significant minutes have been in Roy Williams' system for many years. They've been in this situation. They've made runs in the tournament, including last year. They know how to handle this situation. They can handle the pressure. They're going to get past the Wildcats and move on to the Final Four.
All right. We have UNC returning to the Final Four for the second straight year. Maybe it'll go better for them than it did last year as they lost by that buzzer beater against Villanova in the finals. So that wraps things up for us in the South region. We're now going to send it on over to the rest of our staff, and the next region that we'll discuss is the East.
What's up, guys? We're going to recap the East region for you guys. So the first matchup we have is number 1 Villanova against number 16 Mount St. Mary. Now, in recent years, a number 16 seed team has not been the number 1 team. I'm going to have to go with Villanova to win this game with fair ease. They're the defending champion. They're very consistent. They won Big East.
Big East coming out, winning the Big East. You know, Josh Hart, led by Josh Hart, Chris Jenkins, Jalen Brunson. I don't really think there's much to it, man. I think Nova's going to cruise right through this one.
All right, so we got...
Props to Mount St. Mary's, though, with at least getting a win, I guess you consider, with that win the other night against New Orleans. But exactly. I think it's safe to say Nova's going to cruise probably.
I mean, it's the defending champions. The next matchup we have is number 8, Wisconsin, taking on Virginia Tech. Now, Wisconsin is a very consistent team. They've been shown to be consistent over the past couple of years. I think they're going to have an easy way against Virginia Tech. What about you, Matt?
I mean, for me, man, I'm with you. I mean, I think, you know, with Tech, you really got Zach Madej coming in there. But with Wisconsin, I like Ethan Happ. I like Nigel Hayes. I expect them to do what they always do, at least play some tough defense. And I like star players. Nigel Hayes, Ethan Happ, I think they're going to control the game. Okay. Bronson Koenig, you know, he'll control the tempo and just dish the rock out to his star players, I think.
You know what? I spelled Wisconsin wrong. Sorry about that, people. I didn't graduate first grade, so, yeah. You know, I mean, yeah.
I don't think the Badgers are too worried, as long as they get that win, right?
As long as they get the win. Next matchup, number 5, Virginia against UNC Wilmington. Now, obviously, Virginia is going to win this matchup, but here's the thing about Virginia. A lot of people forget that last year they were one of the more dominant teams in the nation. They were number 1 at some point last year, but this year they kind of fell off, but they did get a 5th seed. So I'm going to have them taking on this game against UNC Wilmington. All right, Matt.
I know a lot of people have been talking about this might be one of the matchups that they might be upset, you know. But I'm riding with UVA. Number 1 defense in the nation, averaging, 55.6 a game. I know the one thing I will say is they might be playing the best defense in the – I mean, they might have the best defense in the nation. Their offense is only second worst, you know,
exactly.
66 points a game. I expect London Parentes. I think the key will be maybe Isaiah Wilkins down low. He needs to be a big shot blocker and make, you know, UNC Wilmington's not very tall, but I think that's the key right there.
Okay, we have our first SEC team on the bracket right now, Florida against Eastern Tennessee State. Now, Florida in the SEC is a very consistent team as well. You know, I'm having them win this game. I really am looking for an upset, but I don't think they're going to be Florida. I don't think Eastern Tennessee State, I feel like they're going to be out very easy. What about you, Matt?
I'm with you, D, man. I mean, I just think this is a – as much as me and you want to pick against Florida.
Exactly.
I think we all want to pick against Florida.
Yeah.
But East Tennessee State, I don't think that much. that's a high scoring offense right there. They're going to put up some serious points, and I expect them to roll, especially with those guards. They get some big time guard play.
Okay. All right, next we're going to have SMU taking on either Providence or USC in the 11th spot. Now, here's the thing about SMU. They are a sleeper team. I've seen them play in the past. They're a really good team. Offensively transition, they're just probably the best team. They can score really easy in the transition. And when you look at either or, I feel like they have a better matchup against Providence. Providence is no joke. Providence are, in the past, they've been a very, very legit team. I remember back in 2014 when they played against North Carolina, I think it was in the Sweet 16.
Yeah.
And Bryce Cotton, I don't know if you guys remember that name, he was phenomenal. He had 39 points, but they lost the game. And if you don't remember, Chris Dunn, he was on Providence last year. Providence, they have really good prospects on that team. But
I think that goes to Cotton, and that was Cotton and Ricky Lato.
Exactly, yeah. That's what's up. But I really don't know who is really if they do play Providence. I really don't know who I want to take. So I'm kind of question mark right now. I really don't know.
I mean, it's tough. I watched USC a couple weeks ago about a week ago play against UCLA in the Pac-12 tournament. Played very well against UCLA. Shot the ball pretty well. I think Simi Olajuwon. It's a tough name, right?
Yeah.
He's fantastic. Mm-hmm. Really good for SMU. I don't think either one of them teams have a big man that could compete with him. Mm-hmm. And I think he's going to really dominate that game. I take SMU, but like I said, I think that's a tough one. But I really like SMU.
It's a tough one for me because, you know, either of these teams can be a sleeper, even USC. Like you said, in the Pac-12 tournament, they played against UCLA. Obviously, they didn't get the win. But USC is a team not to sleep on, basically.
That is 100% a better Southern Cal team than you used to.
Yeah, exactly. Next, we're going to have number 3, Baylor against New Mexico State. The Aggies of New Mexico State. Is it New Mexico State Aggies?
Yes, man.
I think
the
so.
The Aggies.
Yeah, Baylor, to me, I haven't really watched them play this year. But in recent years, they have been a really legit team. New Mexico State, I really don't know anything about them that much. But Baylor, to me, I feel like they're going to take this matchup and just by landslide. What about you, Matt?
I think Jonathan Motley, you know, Baylor's star player, he's going to pretty much – I don't think they have anything to match up against him. Coming from somebody that did live in New Mexico for a couple of years.
All right.
Las Cruces coming down to Las Cruces, but I don't think it's going to be enough. New Mexico State, they always really do come to the tournament. They don't play bad. They're a really good offensive team. I just don't think it's going to be enough. And I know we're going a little chalk on these, but these are some really – and we talked about it. I think this is the hardest region, in my opinion. Mm-hmm. So there's some high-quality teams from 1 through 8, and I expect most of them to take care of business at the bat.
Okay, now next we have moment of truth, South Carolina against Marquette. Now, when you look at South Carolina, obviously they lost against Alabama in the SEC tournament. It was a big loss for us. But when you like I said, go back and look at the play, Sendarius Stoneware has to be – well, Sendarius Stoneware, the SEC Player of the Year. A lot of players had to step up, like P.J. Dozier and Fielder off the bench. But Marquette isn't a team that you can just forget about. You know, their offense is very raw, and I think it will come down the wire. But I'm going to have South Carolina taking this game, a very close game.
I think it's going to be a close game, and it's actually on the BPI rankings. Mm-hmm. It's considered the closest matchup of the first round of all the matchups. So, like I said, man, I think the key to this game really comes down to what it's been most of the year. Chris Silva trying to stay out of foul trouble. Mm-hmm. We need him to be big down low. And, you know, three-point shooting. Can Dwayne notice? Can PJ throw in their two cents, I guess you could say, throw in their batch and really help out Sendarius throughout the game? And
a lot of fans are counting on the Splash Senior. So we're going to
go with USC.
Gotta go with USC. Last matchup, Duke Troy. Troy, I'm not saying Troy doesn't have but Duke, Jason Tatum is just ridiculous. That tandem they have, Jason Tatum, Grayson Allen, that three-point specialist they have on that team is just phenomenal.
And Giles is really starting to come on now.
Exactly.
Neil Jefferson down low is fantastic. Mm-hmm. Offense rebounding. So I don't think this is really a –
just all
Duke.
So we're just going to go back up to the top. Villanova against Wisconsin. All right, so I have Villanova again, defending champions. This team is just on a roll, especially from the momentum they had last year. Chris Jenkins is the sole motivator of this team. So I'm going to have to go with Villanova in the next round.
I love Nigel Hayes. I love Ethan Happ. But I'm a bigger fan of Chris Jenkins and Josh Hart, man. I think they're going to roll through Wisconsin, I mean, Villanova is very, very good, and they're going to continue to show why they are defending champs.
All right, we're back at UVA in Florida. Florida, once again, another consistent team. I don't think UVA has the offensive firepower to go against Florida. Their defense is very legit. All right, Matt, what you got about this, man?
It's a tough call, man. This one, this is a great matchup because this is probably some of the best guards in the nation literally going at it. It's going to be a tough one. I don't know. I think we're on the fence against it. Me and you are really on the fence of this. I roll with Florida on you. I really think that maybe if UVA can slow them down, slow the tempo down, and London Perrantes picks up where he hasn't been lately. You know, he hasn't been playing good lately. If they can do it, I take the UVA guards over Florida guards. But in the end, I don't know. We'll go Florida on that one.
All right, we got Florida. So next matchup is SMU. I'm sorry.
SMU.
SMU and Baylor. Once again, a sleeper team of mine because of the transition offense they have. They're just too legit. They know how to run the – and the thing about SMU, they can feed in low off the transition or they can kick out and shoot a three. So I'm going to have to go with SMU on it with the next round.
You're going to go SMU?
SMU.
I like battle-tested teams. I think Baylor's battle-tested in the Big 12. It's a tough call. But we'll ride with you. I'll ride with D on this one.
All right.
But this is going to be – that'll be a great matchup. That'll be a great matchup. I think the only thing I give Baylor the edge in is – they've been through a gauntlet in the Big 12. I think the Big 12 and ACC are the best two conferences, so it'll be interesting to see how it plays out.
All right, next round we have USC and Duke. Okay, USC had a very fantastic season. They had a couple of games where they lost, but like I said, that tandem of Duke, Grayson Allen, Jason Tatum, and the rest of that Duke team, Luke Kennard, they're just not slowing down the three. South Carolina's defense isn't that good, so I'm going to have to roll with Duke. As much as it kills me to say it, Duke will win this next round.
Yeah, and like you said, we didn't even – touch on Kennard. Kennard's been unreal this year. He's been fantastic. As much as I want to take USC in this thing, if I had to pick a bracket, taking Duke, but I would love to see the upset. Go Gamecocks.
All right, Villanova and Florida. Villanova, once again, the defending champions. I feel like no one's going to slow this team down. This team really wants to prove themselves, especially after last year, after hitting that clutch shot against North Carolina. So I'm going to have to go with Villanova in the next round as well.
Yeah, man. I think I told you earlier, this is my favorites. I know it's hard to go back-to-back, but I have them cruising, and I think Villanova will be on their way to some serious stuff.
My sleeper team, SMU and Duke. Okay, this is where the line draws for SMU. I'm sorry. They're just, like I said, this offense is just too good. Duke, it's probably the best offense I've seen in years since the days of J.J. Redick. The rivalry back in the early 2000s. But Duke, I feel like they're going to just power their way in against SMU. I have them winning this game. What about you, Matt?
Yeah, I mean, like you said, man, there's just too much talent on the team, too much firepower. Duke can beat you in so many different ways. If they want to go down low with Emile Jefferson and Giles, or they can beat you in the outside shot with Grayson Allen, Tatum, or whatever. I just think Kennard and them are too much, and there's too much talent on that team.
All right, finally, we
for
have
the trip to the Final Four.
Final Four. Villanova and Duke. Now, I think this is probably the best offensive game in the tournament, only because both of these teams can put up points. Both of these teams are very consistent offensively. Both of these teams have great coaches, especially Duke with the great Mike Krzyzewski. So it's a hard call for me, only because Duke is just so fantastic offensively. They can kill you so many ways. And even if that defense is not that good, that offense backs up for it. Villanova, they're just all around just great. But I'm going to have to go with Villanova.
The way I look at it, Duke's a fantastic team, very talented. But when it comes down to these type of games where it's really, you know, it matters. I'm going with the senior guys. I'm going with the guys that have been there before. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. I like Nova. I think, you know, with Josh Hart, Chris Jenkins, Jalen Brunson, these guys have been there, obviously. They've done it. And I like the team. I think they're a better team overall.
And that's the thing about Villanova, as you can see from a year ago against North Carolina in that championship game, they're not afraid to play under pressure. So Villanova is just going all the way in this region, man. I'm sorry, but y'all just got to get knocked down by Villanova.
Like I said, Duke is probably maybe a little bit more talented, but I'm taking the older guys. I'm taking Nova.
Well, this is the East region for you guys. I hope you guys basically pick similar to what we had. For Capital City Sports, I'm D'Angelo Stevenson.
I'm Matt Gather.
And we're going to send it off to Joe and Devin.
All right, thanks, guys. So now we're going to talk about the West region. And so our first game is Gonzaga and South Dakota State.
I think you have to go with Gonzaga here. I mean, it's a 1-16. No 16 seed has ever won. That's going to continue right here.
Yeah, I got to agree with you. Gonzaga is a very, very good team this year. Obviously, they deserve that number one seed. And a 16 seed has never, in the history of the tournament, won against a number one. So we'll go with Gonzaga.
It's a very good pick. All right, next we got number 8 Northwestern versus number 9 Vanderbilt. Big storyline here is this is Northwestern's first tournament ever. Unfortunately, I think it's going to be a short tournament because Vanderbilt's going to knock them out first day.
Yeah, like you said, Northwestern, first time ever being in the big dance. Vanderbilt is also kind of an historic game in that aspect because Vanderbilt is, they have 15 losses, and they're the first 15-loss team to ever make the tournament. But Vanderbilt's been really hot lately. They beat Florida 3 times this year, including in the conference tournament, so we're going to go with Vandy.
Yeah, they've had a lot of good games. They've played a lot of good teams. Even the ones they lost, they didn't get blown out, which helped them.
All right, next we have a 5-12 matchup with Notre Dame and Princeton.
Princeton, of course, won the Ivy League championship, which helped them get here, but it's not going to help them win against Notre Dame. Notre Dame is in the ACC, of course. Great conference. They've a great team, and they're going to move on.
Yep, again, got to agree with them. Number 5, Notre Dame, they played in ACC, which is the best conference in basketball right now. They lost the ACC championship to Duke, but like Vanderbilt, they've been playing really well lately, and I think that momentum will carry into the tournament, so the Irish advance.
Now we got number 4 West Virginia and 13 Bucknell. West Virginia, they're Press Virginia, that's their nickname, because that's what they do. They press it and they make you turn the ball over, and that's exactly what they're going to do. Bucknell's going to turn the ball over, and West Virginia is going to handle them.
Yeah, I think that fantastic West Virginia defense is going to prevail. So Bucknell, I really don't think this game is going to be that close with West Virginia taking it. So next we have Maryland and Xavier. So
both teams are really good, but Xavier was the hot team coming in. They did really well in their tournament before they lost to Creighton. And I think that that's going to continue now. I think they're going to take care of Maryland. I think it's going to be an 11-6 upset.
Yeah, again, I'm going to agree. This 11 seed to me is very misleading with Xavier. And I just think overall they're a better team. And Maryland just doesn't – there's something about them that just doesn't have a tournament team feel. So
exactly.
Go with Xavier.
Now we got number 3, FSU, and number 14, Florida Gulf Coast, a.k.a. Dunk City. Some people are going to remember Dunk City from a few years ago when they were in the tournament. They made a run that year, and I think they can do it again. I think they get the upset here, and I think they beat Florida State.
Yep, we got an all-Florida matchup down in Orlando. Dunk City is going to do it again. They did it to George Mason. They're going to do it to Florida State. So Florida Gulf Coast.
Now we got number 7, St. Mary's, and number 10, VCU. Again, good matchup. Both really good teams. VCU is just a better team, in my opinion. They're going to go out there. It's going to be a close one. VCU is going to pull it off.
Yep, I got to agree. VCU has really been doing really well in tournaments, and they're just a better team this year. VCU.
Number 2, Arizona, and number 15, North Dakota. Arizona's a really good team this year. I really, really like them. North Dakota won their championship. That was a great way to get to the tournament. Congratulations to them, but it's going to end early for them. Arizona's going to have no trouble. We're not going to have a repeat of Michigan State last year with them.
No, again, you've got to agree. Arizona, I think, is one of the best choices for the final. They for the Final Four with one of the best teams in their division or their conference. So they'll advance.
Let's jump back up to the top. We got 1 Gonzaga against number 9 Vanderbilt. Both good teams. Gonzaga, I know a lot of people have said they haven't played anyone, and that may be true, but they are a good team. That's why they're a 1 seed. That's why they're undefeated throughout the entire year until they played BYU, and so they're going to take care of Vanderbilt and move on.
Yeah, as good as Vanderbilt has been this year, Gonzaga is just a much better team, and so I just think they will prevail over Vanderbilt, who, in a way, kind of sneaked in this year.
Now we got Notre Dame at number 5 and West Virginia at number 4. Notre Dame is a team that doesn't turn the ball over, and that's how West Virginia wins. Notre Dame is going to limit their turnovers, and they're going to beat that press. And without that press, West Virginia really has nothing, so Notre Dame moves on.
Yeah, West Virginia had that fantastic defense like we talked about earlier, but Notre Dame, they don't turn the ball over. That just hasn't happened very much. So the Irish advance to the Elite Eight.
Now we got number 11, Xavier, and 14, Florida Gulf Coast. Florida Gulf Coast is an athletic team. They're an offensive rebounding team. They can shoot, but when they miss, it doesn't matter because they're going to get the rebound and they're going to put it back up, and I think that is huge, especially in the tournament. That's how you win games. I think Florida Gulf Coast keeps on going to the Sweet 16.
Dunk City, Part 2, Florida Gulf Coast.
Number 10, VCU, and number 2, Arizona. Again, like we said, I really like Arizona this year. They're athletic, they're big, they can shoot, they can do everything, and they're going to keep on moving.
Yep, Arizona, one of the best in the Pac-12, big guys. VCU's a good team, but Arizona just all around, they're one of the best in basketball right now. All right, so next we have Gonzaga and Notre Dame.
Both really good teams, but this is where I think Gonzaga not playing anyone all year really comes to hurt them. Notre Dame being in the ACC, they play great teams. They have the experience in high-pressure situations, and I think they get it. They can shoot. They can make free throws. They got it all.
Yeah, Notre Dame, they play in the ACC. They have big guys who can do everything. And Gonzaga, that's when their schedule's going to finally catch up to them. So then Notre Dame, Fighting Irish, advance.
All right, and then down here we got 14, Florida Gulf Coast against number 2, Arizona. Both teams good. Florida Gulf Coast, I think they're going to get this far on their athleticism alone. But you cannot beat Arizona on athleticism alone, because Arizona, they've got athleticism. They got shooting. They can do everything, and they're moving on.
Yeah, I mean, Arizona is one of my Final Four teams. They're just all around one of the best teams in the country. Florida Gulf Coast, you know, Dunk City, it's a nice story. But it's just not going to happen. Arizona is just too good.
All right, and in the Elite Eight matchup in the West region, we got number 5 Notre Dame and number 2 Arizona.
Like I said, Arizona is one of my Final Four teams. I just think they have good big guys. They can do everything. So I don't see Notre Dame stopping them as good of a season they have had.
I agree completely. Notre Dame, they've had a great year, but they've had to face some tough teams that they haven't been able to beat, and Arizona's going to be one of those teams that's going to continue. Arizona, I think they're going to go far in this tournament. I think they're really well. I think they're heavy contenders to be the champions, and so they're coming out of the West.
All right, so from the West, we got Arizona going to Arizona for the Final Four. So that's all for us. Now we're going to go to the Midwest region with Jack and Matt.
Thanks, Joe. Thanks, Devin. So now it's time to, you know, analyze the Midwest region.
And here, number 1 seed in the Midwest, we got Kansas. They'll either be facing NCC or UD. No surprise here. No 16 seed has ever beaten a 1 seed. We're going to have Kansas advancing.
Yeah, we're not going to see that happen this year. I mean, there are some fairly weak 1 seeds, but as the 16 seeds are also fairly weak, so that's just not going to happen. Next, we got Miami and Michigan State. And Michigan State, you know, they're the bracket busters as of late, but they're playing with a lot less veteran leadership, and that's how they have won. Izzo has been able to rely on his veterans to get them through, and they have one of the youngest rosters in the bracket this year. Miami is a very solid defensive team. They are able to play a great defense without fouling, and that's what I think is going to push them through.
Yeah, I also have Miami in this game. We got a great coaching matchup here. Jim Larrañaga versus Tom Izzo. Going to be a good game. Miami coming out of the ACC, just a better overall conference this season. We're going to push Miami through here.
Don't really know why we put FL, because Miami-Ohio basketball hasn't been relevant in a while, but whatever. Next, we got Iowa State and Nevada.
Little 5-12 matchup.
Oh, yeah.
For Iowa State, I think that they advance here. They're hot coming off a Big 12 tournament championship. They got a great point guard in Monte Morris. He's one of the best players in college basketball. I really think that they're going to win this game.
Yep, I have nothing to say that would disagree with that. They were great in the tournament, winning their division, or their conference, excuse me. And they're on a roll right now. So.
All right, here we got 4-13, Purdue versus Vermont. What do you think about this one?
I mean, Vermont, they were able to make their way into the bracket. They don't play a whole lot of, you know, really good teams. We saw them here at Columbia, mm-hmm. and they were a solid team, but not good enough. I think Purdue is consistent. They're not one of the sexier teams in the bracket, but they win. They get games done.
Purdue, they got the star power, Caleb Swanigan, double-double machine. I really do believe that Purdue's going to advance. I mean, so far, we don't have any upsets, but I just don't see one so far in this region.
Yeah, this is not a – they've got Kansas, Oregon, and Louisville in this bracket, but I don't see a whole lot of room for upsets here. Next, we got Creighton and Rhode Island, some lower-level teams, but I think it's going to be an exciting game. What about you?
I do too. I mean, here is where I think the upset is going to happen. URI, University of Rhode Island, is coming off of an A-10
tournament championship. They're hot right now. I think they've won 8 games in a row. I see them pulling off the upset. Creighton lost their star point guard with a torn ACL earlier in the season, and they haven't been the same. They've been 6-7 after that injury.
This is true, but I do have to disagree with you. I do think Creighton has enough talent to pull through. Rhode Island was able to win their championship off of a game that VCU basically lost. They did not play that well, and VCU is still a higher seed in the bracket. They're a 10 seed.
They're a 10 seed.
So I don't think Rhode Island has enough. I know they're on fire right now, and I think they have Allen Iverson's cousin.
They do.
They
yes.
do have him in their team, but I don't think that the DNA is going to be enough. I believe Creighton will win. They don't have – Rhode Island does have more top 25 wins, so I just think Creighton has enough, but, I mean, I could understand how Rhode Island would win. It would, but it would be an upset in my mind.
We'll write Creighton down, but do not be shocked if Rhode Island pulls off that upset.
Of course. Next game we got 3-14, Oregon and Iona.
Iona.
That's how it
yeah.
is. Yeah.
Iona, New York. Going to be a good game. Iona's a good shooting team. Oregon lost their big man. I don't know if that is going to be enough. I think Oregon, with Dylan Brooks, he's got that clutch factor. They're a good basketball team, and I just don't see the upset.
Chris Buescher, he was a big impact for their defense. He was a good – he was a rim, all-around rim player. But I think Dylan Brooks has the clutch ability to get them fairly far in this bracket. Next, we got Michigan and Oklahoma State. What a story Michigan has become. After the plane crash or plane falling off the runway – playing in practice jerseys and then going 4-for-4.
Winning the Big Ten tournament. I mean, it's big. They're hot right now. They're a great team. They're athletic. Mm-hmm. They can run the floor. They can control the game. They're one of the most athletic teams in the country, but they're going up against one of the best offensive teams in the country in Oklahoma State. They are the number one adjusted offensive efficiency team in the country.
Wow.
All right, their guard, Juwan Evans, can make a play from anywhere on the court. This is going to be the biggest game in the round of 64. The winner of this game has major implications on this entire region. And probably the winner of this game could see themselves in the Final Four.
I can see that very well. And I think Oklahoma State has a great offense, but I think Michigan is making a beeline, pun intended, straight to the Final Four.
There we go. We're putting Michigan through.
Yep. And then, last but not least, 2-15, Louisville versus the other Gamecocks of Jacksonville State. That's the first time that both Gamecocks in the NCAA.
I did not know that the
yep.
Jacksonville State is
the Gamecocks. First time that they're both in the bracket together, and I mean that's just going to be a decimation. Louisville is they're playing in the ACC, which that's a whole different argument there. But they have been able to be very effective in the ACC.
We're gonna push Louisville through here.
Oh, yeah.
Now I do have to say this entire region has incredible coaches. We got Bill Self at Kansas, Jim Larrañaga at Miami, Tom Izzo at Michigan State, and then we got Coach Rick Pitino down here. And don't forget John Beilein. Yep.
You cannot forget him coaching from VCU and coaching at, I believe it's VCU, I might be wrong, and then Western Virginia, and then coming to Michigan. And I think his career alone stands out and helps Michigan play the way they are now.
All right, going back up here, we got Kansas, Miami. What do you think about that one?
Now, Miami has been playing in the ACC, which is the best conference, I believe, in
definitely
NCAA basketball.
Definitely the best conference in college
However,
basketball this season.
However, Kansas is one of the, not one of the strongest, but they are strong enough.
They deserve their one seed.
They're
a great basketball team.
They were faltering a bit. They have had some upsets with TCU and other teams like that, but I don't think there's going to be upset here. What about you?
Nope, I don't see it. Kansas is a great basketball team. Freshman Josh Jackson is super talented. And the only reason why they lost in the Big 12 is because he was suspended. I think they're very deserving of that number one seed, and they're going to advance to Sweet 16 here.
Yep. And then another 5-4, Iowa State and Purdue. Here's where I think an upset lies. I believe Iowa State is on a roll again. Mm-hmm. They were able to win their championship, and I believe that's going to be enough to push Purdue through.
Very, very true. It's going to stay hot.
Oh, yeah.
Stay hot. Now we got Creighton, Oregon. I don't know how you feel about this one, but I take Oregon here.
I would too. If it was Rhode Island, then I could see some, but
exactly.
And that's where our arguments lie, and that's where my bracket was.
Possibility Rhode Island finds their way in the Sweet 16, folks.
If Rhode Island could get through with the way they play, I could see them beating Oregon, but I just don't think. I think Dylan Brooks is able. His star power is enough to motivate the team. To have that much of a clutch factor to win those many games on the final seconds, I think when the game is on the line, he turns it on. He gets that look in his eyes, and he can win games. That's their saving grace right there. He can just push them through.
Mm-hmm. Now, here we got Michigan-Louisville. I think we said this before. We're going to take Michigan here. They're super athletic. They've been playing very well together. The chemistry is there
And they've won it.
They're making shots. If you're as athletic as a team as they are and you're making shots, you're going to be hard to beat. And I just don't see them losing.
Their Beeline asked them after it was all happening if they wanted to continue and play the tournament for their championship or if they just wanted to forfeit, and they want the wins. They had a faltering end of the season, but they turned it back on coming into the championship and coming into that tournament. I think that's going to push them through.
Another team that's staying hot that won their conference tournament, Iowa State and Michigan, both in this region.
And I honestly think, in my personal bracket, but the more I picked Oregon, but the more and more I analyze it, I think it's going to be Michigan over Oregon.
Yes.
And I think
Michigan here.
And I also, I don't know about you, but I think Kansas is one of the more faltering number one seeds. I think that they were one of the ones that they deserve it, but there were other people that could have gotten it. I see Michigan, Iowa State.
Michigan, Iowa State.
I don't know about you, and you could argue that.
I like it. I would personally take Kansas, but.
Well, then here, talk your point. You know, argue with me.
All right. Well, that's just because Kansas has more star power. They got senior guard Frank Mason. He's one of the players of the year.
He is very good.
Listen, and if you want to talk about a clutch player, he's one of the best of them. That man can play, and he's a veteran. He knows the game. He could slow the pace down. He knows how to controls the tempo, really understands the game. And Kansas is a very talented team. They're very deserving of a number one overall seed, and they could very well be in this game.
I just think that with the way this season has gone, there have been multiple number one ranked teams in this year. Kansas was one of them.
Big 12 is a great conference. Iowa State and Kansas are very familiar with each other, and I could definitely see the upset as well, but I would take Kansas.
I've seen there's been a lot of upsets. West Virginia has been a team that's able to upset, and Iowa State took down, I believe they took down West Virginia in the finals. And I just think, I mean, I just see...
Staying hot.
I think they're staying hot. I see
conference tournament
win. I think the biggest thing that's important, one of the most important things about this bracket is conference championships and winning those tournaments. I think they can keep the momentum, both teams here. And I think in a bracket that has, you know, not as much... I mean, they do have, like, the East, you know, they have a lot of firepower in the East as well. But I just think that there's going to be a lot of upsets in this.
So now we got two teams... Both coming off conference victories in the Elite Eight, Iowa State and Michigan. Who do you got?
For me, I'm liking I wouldn't call it a Cinderella because they are a seventh seed. However, so are the South Carolina Gamecocks, and that would be a Cinderella story. But I got to pick Michigan.
I'm liking
the way they're going.
We're
going
to take the Wolverines here. We see Michigan heading to the Final Four this year.
I think the state of Michigan has had some bracket busting in the past couple years, and I think Michigan is going to keep that trend going. They'll be the next, you know, Michigan State, except they'll get farther. And I think that the way this is going, there's a lot of teams in here that aren't, you know, the flashiest teams. They don't have, you know, the biggest wins, but they're consistent. They can score. A lot of them are athletic. This is I think one of the more closer regions of the bracket.
A few, but exciting upsets here. There's going to be some great games in this region. Mm-hmm. And watch out for this one, Michigan, Oklahoma State, and Creighton, Rhode Island.
Those are our games of this bracket. And I think also Miami, Michigan State.
Very true. All right. Thank you, guys.
That's all from us. Now, remember, these are our picks. You can either listen to them or not. We're not responsible for any bets you make or any money you lose. But these are the team. And any team that gets in the bracket has a chance to make it far. But
everybody's got a shot. It's March Madness, people.
So for all the guys and for everyone at Capital City Sports and all the guys in video today, I'm Jack Taylor.
I'm Matt Mbaka.
Thank you guys for watching.